Hi, I'm Dr. Philip McMillan, and welcome again this evening or morning, wherever you are in the world, as I'll be talking a little bit more about vaccine-induced myocarditis, this time confirmed by biopsies. And I'm focused on the silent part of the disease. And as usual, when we have these conversations, we focus on a very specific part of a paper so that this is peer-reviewed, evidence-based discussions. For anyone who doesn't know, I have been focused on autoimmunity in COVID-19 since March of 2020. I've been shouting as loudly as I can that severe COVID-19 is a viral-mediated autoimmune disease. If you want to understand more about what I'm sharing, I'd encourage you to join me on my Substack for posts, podcasts, and videos since March 2020. So I've been sharing a lot of information, and I will continue to educate you as best as I can. And so today, I'm focused on the silent part of this vaccine-induced myocarditis. And here I have beside me a paper. I'll make it full screen so you can read it. So this is intramyocardial inflammation after COVID-19 vaccination, an endomyocardial biopsy-proven case series. And what that means is that they actually got from the heart of the patients samples of tissue to confirm inflammation or myocarditis. Myocarditis is really inflammation of the heart. And I'm going to be focused on a very specific part of that discussion. And before I do, I'll always mention this is a study that was done in Germany. The funding for it was from the European Regional Development Fund, so that's a good sign. There were no conflicts of interest, also a good sign. The funders had no role in the design of the study, and so all seems good. This should be a good, clear picture as to what's going on with regards to the disease. So let's break down a little bit as to what I want to talk about. So as I said, I'm focused on the silent vaccine-induced myocarditis because for anyone who knows what I've been talking about now for some time, I have been absolutely insisting that we should be mandating autopsies. This is the only way we get full histopathological evidence of what's going on in the pandemic. We need autopsies, we need biopsies in order to make sure that everything is okay. So here, let's go into what I wanted to show you. I'm going to show you the data. They did about 15 cases. And these were people who had symptoms of myocarditis, and then they took a biopsy from inside the heart. Then they checked it under the microscope, and they confirmed in 14 of them, in 93% of the cases, that they had vaccine-induced myocarditis. It's important to state that the authors cannot absolutely be sure that it's the vaccine that has caused it, but the association is so close that they would think that it is likely that it is relevant. Okay, so here is the starting point of what we've got. I love to look at the data around these presentations as opposed to just the paper, because sometimes when you look at it clinically, you get a different interpretation of what's going on. And this is what I'm going to be sharing with you now. So here is the data that I took from the paper. The link is in the description below. And so you have here all of the patients, patients 1 through to patient number 15. It shows you here the vaccine that was used, two of them Johnson & Johnson, two of them AstraZeneca, and the other 11 were Pfizer. None of them were Moderna. And I think that's just because it was in Germany. It shows you here the age, ranging from the lowest age of 18 all the way up to the oldest age of 68, and whether or not they're male or female. So you have a mix. I think most of them were male, the others were female. And so I'm going to be going through this in a little bit more detail, not too complex, but I want to show you a few images to understand when we talk about left ventricular ejection fraction. and I'll show you the full thing again. You'll notice that in all of these here, they have this LVEF, which is left ventricular ejection fraction, and the percentage. And you have going down what the percentage is for each patient. So for one, he had an elective ventricular ejection fraction of 12%. Now, the normal is about 55 to 75. And you would expect in younger people that it would tend to be around 70% or so. In older people, normally it could be lower, about 55. In all of these patients, their left ventricular ejection fraction was always at least borderline or severe. So where do we get this from? It's from an echocardiogram. All right. And that's where it's kind of an ultrasound of the heart. And I've got a picture here that I hope will help you to understand. So here you have a lady putting the probe on someone's chest, and they put some jelly there as well. And that helps them to look at the heart from the outside and to see how the heart is pumping, and lets them look at the valves as well. So many people have been through that. It's not painless, and it's quite comforting, I guess, for some people, because there's this jelly and somebody's rubbing a probe on your chest, so it shouldn't be too bad. Then we have what the images look like, and that's there. I'm going to come back to that, but that's kind of what the images look like. But before I come to it, I want you to see what a normal heart looks like. This is a normal heart that is pumping away, and you can see that the ventricles are the bigger part. This part here are the ventricles, the atria are just behind it, and this is really what pumps the blood around the body, and this is what we tend to be measuring with the left ventricular ejection fraction. So every time it pumps, what percentage of the blood in the heart is pushed out of the heart? And as I said, in the normal person, that could be usually up to about 75%, normal, healthy, young individual. And so when we look at the echocardiogram, as you can see in this picture here, this shows the heart muscle not really contracting too much. And so this person would have a poor left ventricular ejection fraction. And this part here is the ventricle, and it would be pumping the blood around the body. So that's the basis as to what it is that it would tend to look like. Now, in terms of the documentation from this paper, and this paper was published in June. I'm so sorry that I hadn't seen it earlier. I'm glad someone shared it with me. So back to the paper now that we've covered that. And what I want to show you now is one specific case. Now, this case is case number 10. This is a lady. She's 38 years old. Let me make sure you can see this. She's 38 years old. Her ejection fraction was 40%. So that's low for a 38-year-old female who has no associated heart disease. These symptoms started after her second vaccine and within 14 days of the presentation. She was found to have reduced left ventricular ejection fraction and a New York Heart Association level of 1. I'm going to pause there a minute. This is the reason why I'm highlighting this. A New York Heart Association function of 1 means you don't really have too many symptoms. This is the classification here. I'll make it big screen. Patient symptoms, no limitation of physical activity. Ordinary physical activity does not cause or induce fatigue, palpitations, or shortness of breath. 2 is slight limitations. 3 is marked limitation. And 4, you can't do any physical activity. So this patient was New York Heart Association 1. So she had no real symptoms. So she was probably presenting with regards to chest pain. And that's why they ended up doing a biopsy to look at it. What's important here is that as I come back to this image and I put it back on full screen, her troponin level, that's a measure of heart damage, was normal. The next one down the line here, I roll up, is her BNP, CK, and CRP. Her BNP, brain natriuretic peptide, is 84, is also normal. Her CK, which is creatine kinase, heart muscle enzyme, was normal. as well as her inflammation markers were normal. However, she had a myocarditis, which seemed to have been induced by the vaccination. That's what I consider so significant, and part of the reason why I have said that it is not good enough for us to only be looking at patients who have significant symptoms when we were trying to assess the degree of myocarditis or the degree of damage that can occur with the heart. This case that I have shown in this 38-year-old, who now has a 40% ejection fraction 14 days after receiving her second dose, barely had any shift with any of the markers that we would measure. And so quite easily, that patient could have been passed on as being just something else. From a clinical perspective, we need to be doing better. We need to identify those patients because that 40% ejection fraction may not recover. Now, up to 75% of myocarditis cases can recover, but the range is 25 to 75%, depending on the paper that you're looking at. So for a lot of these patients, they can be left with significant damage to their heart down the line. The reason I highlight this is not that this is a criticism of vaccination. My concern has always been that the minute you shifted our target from the high-risk cohort, we needed to be absolutely sure that the risk was worth the benefit. 95% of patients who had severe COVID-19 had at least one comorbidity. We knew who they were. That was the group to target. And even now, as some countries are starting to pull back on vaccinating under 30s and so on, I think that this action has been too late. It is good, but we didn't need to be in that position if we had done the adequate biopsy and autopsy studies. That has always been my argument. And it is important for us, even now as we reflect on the way forward out of the pandemic, for us to not make the mistake of discounting how important it is to have autopsies and biopsies when we are making decisions about the future and the potential risk of any intervention, whether it be now or in the future. I hope that is of value to you. I hope that makes sense. And it was just a quick point to highlight how important it is that even with minor symptoms from a clinical context, we should not discount it. We should always investigate it thoroughly. Have a great evening, everyone, and thank you for listening.